in a bigger sense, to discuss what the healthcare delivery system of this great state should look like. And that's really what it's all about. So let me start off by saying what this report and what this meeting is not about. And I want to make it very clear, I am, and I think the Commission in general, is very proud of the healthcare delivery system of Massachusetts and our great academic medical centers. I mean, I sort of indirectly represent you, because I spent a lot of time on airplanes and flying around the country explaining why, in a not so subtle way, the state of Massachusetts is so far ahead of the rest of the country. I mean, I'm not shy about that. I must admit that. And it has to do with the quality and the breadth of the delivery system here in Massachusetts. So this is not in a sort of a condemnation of our big academic, high-quality institutions. What it is about is a balanced delivery system. And that's very important to not lose sight of. In the report itself, I want to just read to you just one line that is in the introduction to Chapter 3, which it says, a high-quality, accessible, and cost-effective healthcare system requires a range of care delivery, a range of care delivery settings so that patients can receive the right level of care in the right place at the right time. That's what this is all about. What we have seen, going back to the early 1980s, is a constant deterioration in the availability of community health care in this state. Much greater. Now, there are some reasons for that, and some reasons are good in terms of maintaining a balanced delivery system. And what's going on in this state is going on around the country. The question is the magnitude of that, and whether there are legitimate changes that should occur to stabilize. Because what's happened is that we saw a significant deterioration in the 80s and 90s in terms of all of the hospitals that closed in this state, for the most part, were either community hospitals and particularly urban community hospitals. I wouldn't say a privilege, but I had the responsibility back in 2000 when we recognized that we had a serious problem to co-chair an organization looking at this, and we saw what was going on. And then it stabilized for a while, but now we're seeing it again, and this report highlights the growing concern that we're going through another phase of sort of a closing and consolidation of our community hospitals. So that's what this is all about. It's to sort of understand the forces that are working to lead to this deterioration and to talk about what we could do about it. I'm not going to go into any more detail. We have a wonderful set of panels set up, but I get one great opportunity to introduce our secretary, who has been a good friend to all of us. We had the privilege of knowing each other for many years in academia and then being on the commission together. Marylou is just really a solid citizen of this great state. I'm sorry, I love her. Come on up. And I just want to say, in my role of going around the country and talking about Massachusetts, I'm particularly proud of what we've done to sort of deal with the opioid and what you've done. Okay, I'll give you a little credit. I'll give you a lot of credit. So, you know, it's a pleasure to introduce Marylou Sudders, our secretary.
So if I close this, will I have just done some terrible malfunction? Huh? It's okay, Colleen. We all know my technology skills are wanting. Well, thank you, Stuart. So I was hoping I was just going to get up here and just say ditto to whatever the chairman had to say. On a more serious note, while Stuart is in academia, quite frankly, I can think of no greater public servant at this moment than Stuart Altman, who was the inaugural chair of the Health Policy Commission, who has strong opinions based on years of experience in the healthcare economic industry and understanding all this, and a willingness to listen to so many different perspectives. So I just, I learned from him. I was actually hoping to learn more from him this morning in terms of his insights. But I think we are, you know, public service is a privilege. And to have someone like Stuart chair the Health Policy Commission from its inception, from the, when the legislature conceived of it, the governor signed it into law, is, I just want to really acknowledge that. So thank you, Stuart.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to those oysters we're going to have.
That's it.
That's right. You know, my father had a saying when I was a little girl, old and wise were not always synonymous. The same is true in healthcare. Expensive care and higher quality care are not always synonymous either. But in the Commonwealth, somehow we have equated the two together and need to have a very different conversation about quality, cost, and access. Of course, there is a role, an extraordinarily important role, for our academic medical centers. They are game changers in research, teaching, and tertiary care. And they are expensive. So as Stuart said, the conversation is not about one or the other, but how to construct a healthcare system in the Commonwealth that values community, teaching, and academic hospitals. The Health Policy Commission's unique role is to have a very public conversation and look into some of our seemingly intractable healthcare conundrums. How do we truly implement the triple aim? That is the premise behind Chapter 224, after all. And I really, you know, as Stuart has travels a lot around the country, I used to travel around the country more before I became secretary, and actually spent a lot of time in North Carolina because I was actually the court monitor over their mental health, substance abuse, and Medicaid system. And I have to tell you, one of the things that Massachusetts did of separating the coverage from the cost and quality conversation was really transformative, because if we hadn't spent the time in getting coverage for folks, we probably would still be mired in that conversation around coverage, cost, quality, access. So the good news is we have 97% or almost 97% of the folks in the Commonwealth with coverage. We all know that that doesn't necessarily equate to access, availability, and good costs, but we've gotten that platform done. And once it's a much better place to have the conversation than in a place like Florida that has 22% of its population without health care coverage. I mean, so I'd much rather us having this conversation at this time than debating on getting people almost universal coverage. HPC's recent report on community hospitals at a crossroads highlights a few key themes. The value proposition, the value of community hospitals to the Massachusetts healthcare system. Community hospitals, so I'm standing here today to tell you that yes, community hospitals are essential to our healthcare system. These include their role in providing more local and convenient access, providing services at relatively lower prices, and at good quality. As the Commonwealth plans for and works towards changes that will result in more sustainable systems, we must ensure that these hospitals are designed to prioritize and build upon the values that our community hospitals have traditionally provided to their communities. The challenges, and we'll get into a lot more about this morning. Despite the important role that community hospitals play in Massachusetts' healthcare system, they have a variety of challenges, driven both by challenges to care delivery, payment models, and yes, market dysfunction. Making traditional community hospitals operating and business models at risk. These challenges reinforce one another and compounded by obstacles that prevented many of these hospitals from effectively addressing them. The future. See, I can do healthcare now like in 10 minutes or less. The future, from community hospitals to community health. We must proactively reshape and reframe community health care rather than reacting or responding only to crises or when a hospital faces closure. The vision is a healthcare system in which patients in Massachusetts are able to get most of their healthcare in local, cost-effective settings. frankly, as Stuart said, we really need to have a conversation not just about community hospitals, but community health. A key theme of the report and this administration's perspective is the need to shift from the traditional fragmented healthcare system to coordinated community-based systems that address the health needs of their communities in a more cost-effective, high-quality manner. To achieve the vision, community hospitals must embrace change, and I know they are. I talk about restructuring, I leave transformation to others. We need to partner closely with community-based providers and emphasize continuity of care post-hospitalization and consider realigning capacity to meet particular unmet needs. During my visits to community hospitals, I have witnessed firsthand community hospitals' commitment to responding to local needs. Most recently, the behavioral health and urgent care expansions in the Harrington Hospital System is one recent example of a hospital system responding to community needs. But let me talk a little bit, because I am actually the largest insurer in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, which is MassHealth. Let me talk for a moment about MassHealth's restructuring, which is really focused on community-based care. The Baker administration is committed to supporting and accelerating delivery system as envisioned and expected through Chapter 224. Primarily, our efforts are focused on restructuring the MassHealth program, the largest insurance program in the Commonwealth at 1.85 million members. The past year, with many people in this room, I notice, we've been working to discuss what the future of MassHealth needs to look like and focused on improving the care and experience of its members, some of our most vulnerable citizens. And I hope as we talk about healthcare today, we will always remember that it's the patient experience that should be at the heart of our conversations. Part of the momentum, of course, is the threat of losing $1 billion as of July 1st, 2017. And if that's not a motivator for change, I'm not sure what is. Going forward, while the Health Policy Commission's report is focused on community hospitals, our focus is not hospital-centric. We are community-centric. We are patient-centric. The health policy report highlights the importance of ensuring that the healthcare delivery system provides the highest quality care in the most cost-effective manner. One of our primary goals is to reduce unnecessary hospital and emergency department visits as we truly improve care coordination for our members through preventive and community-based services. In healthcare, people often talk about providing patients with the right care in the right setting at the right time. The HPC report focuses on the setting of care, which is a critical part of the equation. Within MassHealth, we're developing models of healthcare delivery with many people in this room, not just on the 11th floor of 1 Ashburton Street, that makes the system more sustainable, including accountable care organizations. ACOs realign incentives so that providers are rewarded for delivering care in the highest quality, lowest cost setting, because they will be paid on the basis of the total cost and quality of care for their patient population. MassHealth is working to ensure that behavioral health and new innovative concepts such as certified community partners across social and long-term supports and services are necessary components. These partners will be community-based providers with experience and expertise serving the needs of people with significant behavioral health and long-term care needs. As everyone knows, MassHealth is an insurance plus program. Given the needs of the MassHealth population, incorporating these kinds of community partners into the ACO program is essential. Human Services is EOHHS is proposing to bring in significant new federal investment funding in the Massachusetts healthcare system through its 1115 waiver agreement with our federal partners, and to extend the DSH pool to more hospitals than the traditional seven, using facts rather than history to support safety net hospitals. If approved, these investment dollars will help to accelerate the adoption of ACO models and would provide much-needed investments in community hospitals, community partners, and other providers such as our community health centers. By mid-April, our MassHealth restructuring plan will be available for public comment. And yes, so I'm going to bring up all the things that are everyone's favorite topics. The governor's budget reflects the commitment to promoting these new community-based care delivery models. MassHealth includes no changes in benefits and would hold most provider payments rates steady, otherwise known as there's no cuts. Importantly, some behavioral health, you know, just calling it for what it is. Importantly, some behavioral health and nursing home providers would see necessary rate increases. This represents a bridge to changes underway at MassHealth. The budget proposal includes an increase to an existing hospital assessment, which some have criticized and my friends in the hospital community refer to as a tax. This assessment, however, is necessary and will be beneficial to our overall healthcare system. It allows the state to increase Medicaid rates and avoid consideration of reduced Medicaid benefits. It also provides the foundation for federal investments in MassHealth movement to value-based payment models. The HPC report calls for continued dialogue among all stakeholders to build a path to a thriving community-based care system. The beginning of that conversation is a goal of today's event and will be a continued focus of this administration and I know the Health Policy Commission. These constructive multi-stakeholder conversations are critical to addressing some of the biggest challenges facing our healthcare system today. Your voices were extraordinarily important in the recently passed opioid bill, which was signed by the governor 2 weeks ago, and was heavily informed by many people in this room, not just by the governor's opioid working group. The groundbreaking law addresses the devastating opioid epidemic through a number of important provisions and represents a significant and meaningful step forward. Two other things I want to highlight. Another significant challenge facing many of our hospitals, highlighted again in the HPC report, is the all-too-common reality of patients left to board in our emergency departments for hours, days, even weeks. It shouldn't take a call to the Secretary of Health and Human Services to resolve a child who's been in an emergency room for almost 3 weeks, which is exactly what happened about a week ago, while waiting for an appropriate care placement. This results in not only a significant burden on our hospitals, but subpar care for patients at a high cost. It's also extraordinarily stigmatizing for patients with behavioral health. The Baker administration is taking this challenge on head first and has convened a group to develop tangible, I'm into tangible and pragmatic, short-term and long-term action items to address this issue. You can expect that report in May, and I'm pleased that Undersecretary Alice Moore has been leading that charge for me. Last, and certainly not least, is provider price variation. I look forward to the conversation that starts tomorrow by the Health Policy Commission, bringing everyone to the table to start to look at the issues of provider price variation, a topic on many, many minds, and the hearings that will be coming up. So we welcome today, we welcome all of these conversations and the many perspectives at the table, which we will have the opportunity for meaningful change to occur and health care to be available to all residents of the Commonwealth that is hopefully affordable, accessible, and of high quality. Thank you.
I'm now going to introduce somebody who I think it's fair to say everyone knows pretty well and of which it's a pleasure to work with, our Executive Director of the Health Policy Commission, David Seltz, who will lead us through the rest of the morning.
All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's event, a conversation to foster a sustainable community health system. It is my pleasure to welcome you here to Suffolk Law University, a familiar venue, I think, for many of you, although a slightly different setup here this morning. I'm really thrilled to see so many familiar faces in the room today, as well as some unfamiliar faces, because this really is an important conversation, and really today is not the end of this conversation, but really the beginning. So I'm really thrilled to see a packed room here this morning. First of all, I want to thank the Secretary for being here today and sharing her perspectives on the future of our healthcare system and the really incredible work across so many different areas that the Baker administration is leading on. And through you, Madam Secretary, to your incredible team, you have assembled an incredibly hardworking, smart, accomplished, and thoughtful team to help you and the governor execute on the ambitious agenda that you've just outlined. And while it's dangerous to name any names, I do want to specifically recognize Commissioner Burrell, Commissioner Makula, Undersecretary Moore, and Assistant Secretary Dan Tsai and his team, who have been just incredible partners to the HPC in really thinking about our shared goals, which is really better health, better care, at lower costs in the Commonwealth. And speaking of shared goals, I know I speak for everyone in this room when I say that we stand ready to help, to support, and to contribute to the success of your efforts around MassHealth restructuring. These reforms are, restructurings are critical to meeting the vision of Chapter 224 and will ultimately benefit not only the members that rely on MassHealth, but the providers who provide services under that program, the managed care organizations that partner with MassHealth, and ultimately the residents of the Commonwealth. We are rooting for you and that $1 billion. As has been mentioned, today's discussion is really a discussion about the future. The future vision of a healthcare system that is accessible, accountable, innovative, equitable, effective, safe, patient-centered, transparent, thriving, and importantly, affordable. Each one of those words means something slightly different. And to develop and advance policies and strategies that address all of those goals is certainly a lofty target. But we're Massachusetts, and we don't back down from lofty targets. We didn't 10 years ago when we set for ourselves the goal of ensuring access to affordable health insurance for every single resident of that state, the 10-year anniversary coming up in just a short, in a week or two. And we didn't 3 years ago when we passed Chapter 224 and set on our course for sustainable healthcare cost growth. And that is really a credit to so many in this room and many who have come before in setting for ourselves the broad goals of the best healthcare system, not only in the country, but in the world. But this vision faces some serious challenges, which we're going to talk about today, most notably from the continued impact of market dysfunction and the dynamic reconfiguration of our healthcare system through consolidations and affiliations, and the pressing need to adapt to new care delivery models and payment systems. These challenges call out for proactive planning, shared action, and discussion, which is why we are here today. And any plan for future action must reflect the history of how we got here and requires an unflinching and comprehensive view of the current issues and the current state, both positive and challenging. That is what we set out to accomplish in this report and through the future work of the HPC. This morning, I'm going to provide a review of some of the key findings from the report. Before I do that, I do want to recognize many people in the room who significantly contributed to this landmark report. First, to the Health Policy Commission's board, you are our leaders in all of the work. You help guide and provide input to the staff, as well as direct us in our policy development. This would not be possible without the dedicated public service of our board. So to you, Mr. Chairman, to our Vice Chair, Wendy Everett, and all of the commissioners here today, Commissioner Cohen, Commissioner Sudders, Commissioner Allen, Commissioner Berwick, representatives of Secretary of Administration and Finance, Rick Lord. thank you for your service, and please just I'd ask for everyone to just acknowledge their incredible work. Secondly, I'd want to recognize the stakeholders that really contributed to this report. We did a tremendous amount of traveling across the Commonwealth and interviewing different perspectives that really fed into this report. The HPC Advisory Council, which is here today, interviewees, and the members of the other state agencies, particularly the Center for Healthcare Information Analysis and the Attorney General's Office, the Auditor's Office, DPH, DMH, and CMS, who all provided work to this. Thank you, and thank you for your incredible contribution. And finally, I do want to recognize the Health Policy Commission staff, who you can always recognize by our fancy blue lanyards. This was an incredible amount of work to put this report together that required everyone in the organization contributing in some way over a year. And so I hope you can also join me in just congratulating the staff and their work on this. So my goal for the next 5 minutes or so is to quickly run through some of the major findings from this report. Many of you have read the report. I'm not going to read the report to you. There are also key findings that are within your programs. The goal really is to just set the stage for our discussion, which is why we are here today. First of all, we began this work with a no preset point of view, and I think that's really important. We really let the facts and the data drive our findings, and those findings were informed by the perspectives of many through over 80 interviews that we conducted over a period of time. Many of those perspectives can be found in select quotes in the report, and would encourage you to read those. A major impetus for this report, though, was the closure of two community hospitals here in Massachusetts, North Adams and Quincy Medical Center. They inspired, I think, a renewed focus on community hospitals, the value they provide, the challenges they face, and the need for proactive planning. The quote here on this slide is an important one and one that we thought a lot about when we were developing this report. I don't see a future for community hospitals. I think there's a fantastic future for community health systems. If standalone hospitals are only doing what hospitals have done historically, I don't see a future for that. But I see a phenomenal future for health systems with a strong community hospital that breaks the mold of patient care. The report, as outlined here, contains kind of four major parts, an overview of community hospitals in Massachusetts, a description of the value that they provide, the challenges, and again, that path forward. Would note that community hospitals have been in a period of transition for really the last three decades, as our chairman highlighted in his remarks. Although there have been few closures really since the 2000s, recent closures notwithstanding, in the 80s and 90s they were quite common, and this is really both positive and negative changes in our healthcare system, changes in care patterns, changes in payment patterns, and technology. But between 1985 and 1999, we lost about a third of the inpatient beds in Massachusetts. Since that time, the number of inpatient beds has been relatively stable, although we've seen shifts about where those beds are and for what services they're providing. Would note here, too, that we have seen a dramatic uptick in activity in recent years. This slide just graphically describes some key facts about community hospitals today, or as of 2013, when this data is from. We have 43 community hospitals. They importantly provide almost two-thirds of emergency department visits in Massachusetts. They tend to treat lower acuity care. They have lower occupancy and a lower age of plant, and importantly, a high public payer mix. They are very varied. We have from the 15-bed Athol Memorial Hospital to the 556 beds that are in the South Coast system, from hospitals that are affiliated with some of our major academic medical centers to hospitals that are truly independent. This was provided a complex challenge for us in this report to really encapsulate all of the nuance that goes into community hospitals. The value. The value that they provide has been well said. It is local access to high-quality care that is efficient and that tends to treat at a higher proportion of those vulnerable populations, and doing so in a community-focused way. We have some key facts in the report that outline every one of these different ideas, and won't go through them in depth, but other to say, this was a core part of what we're here to help preserve. As we transform and change our system, how can we ensure that these concepts, these values, are present in our future state? The challenges facing community hospitals. The challenge wheel that we've described in the report includes many different dynamics around our healthcare system today, from patient preferences for academic medical centers and teaching hospitals, to changes in consolidations and referral patterns that ultimately results in lower volume, and specifically lower commercial volume at community hospitals, often at a lower price. This all leads to destabilized financial position and a limited ability to reinvest and to address those barriers to transformation. I'm going to show a few key findings here because this was really a place where we did some particularly new work. One, and I won't talk through all of this, is we did commission 8 focus groups of patients to talk about what they value when deciding where to go and receive care. Importantly, many patients feel that they did not have a choice in where to seek hospital care. 2 in 3 residents through our focus groups had never sought out quality or price information, and many equated price and cost with quality. Speaking to the Secretary's points before, how do we break down those assumptions, and what information can we provide to consumers so that they can make high-value choices is a question that we want to raise to participants today. Our system is increasingly consolidated. We looked at the affiliation for physicians, particularly, and found that the percentage of PCPs affiliated with 8 largest systems is increased from 62% to 76%. And I do want to just read a quick quote here from the report. Retaining primary care staff and specialists, the quote, gatekeepers to volume, is challenging. Providers continue to leave for big name systems and AMCs, and patients follow. That was a synthesis of some of our hospital CEO interviews. We have done previous work that looks at where patients go to receive their care and find that much care does migrate to downtown Boston from other regions of the Commonwealth. Those patients tend to be commercially insured. They tend to come from higher income communities. And we find that they are going downtown for a whole range of services. Here we looked specifically at deliveries, low acuity deliveries, and found some variation, but really across the Commonwealth, people leaving their home region to receive community appropriate deliveries in downtown Boston. And we also looked at routine care that is being provided at our downtown AMCs and found a significant proportion of the care provided we classified as routine care that was from regions outside of Boston. We recognize that there is some trends that go beyond Massachusetts, and the shift from inpatient to outpatient is one of these important trends. Community hospitals have a particular challenge here. They already have low occupancy, and if we think about the trends moving forward, we see even lower occupancy rates for community hospitals in the future. This can destabilize the financial position. I would note, though, that there is some variation underneath this, that while community hospitals have lower occupancy rates for medical and surgical beds, for behavioral health beds, their occupancy rates are over 90%. Finally, and this will be a topic of conversation both today and tomorrow, we note that community hospitals tend to have lower commercial relative prices than AMCs and teaching hospitals, and that those hospitals with a high payer mix tend to actually have lower commercial prices, compounding that financial stress, and that the concept of cross-subsidization is not one that we observe consistently in our marketplace. The path forward. Really, the concepts behind this report were to tee up this conversation that I'm going to now turn to. How can we break the traditional model and really plan for the future? How do we re-envision what communities hospitals can offer and the role that they play in our healthcare system? and what is our path forward, both in terms of planning and support for community hospitals, the role of consumers and employers and labor in that conversation, and the way that payment reform can help to build a sustainable and thriving healthcare system for the future. Thank you for allowing me to go through some of our key findings relatively quickly. I wanted to do that to ground us in the conversation to come, and with that, I am excited to move to that conversation. So it is my honor to introduce Derek Feeley, President and CEO of the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, as our first moderator, to join me and to moderate this first panel. IHI, as many of you know, was founded in the late 1980s by our Commissioner Berwick and many others, and has been a leading force in continuous improvement of both our healthcare system and healthcare systems across the world. And is probably most well known for kind of introducing and promoting this concept of the triple aim, which is really at the heart of both Chapter 224 and the Health Policy Commission and all of our efforts here in Massachusetts. Derek has an incredible biography, which I won't read to you, but he has been a great leader for IHI, a national leader, and a friend in the development of this report. He puts the moderate in moderator, and I specifically wanted that because we have some incredible voices who are going to be joining on this panel. I've warned him he may have his hands full, but I could think of no one better to lead this conversation. So please join me in welcoming Derek. You want to stay up?
Thank you, David. I think I can safely say that of all of the introductions I've ever had, that was easily the most recent. So we're going to introduce our eminent panel. So knowledgeable and expert are this group of people that we thought we would throw them a curveball. It's getting near the start of the baseball season, April 4th, just around the corner. And that is, they're going to have to interpret my Scottish accent. What's worse, it's a Scottish accent with a cold. So I apologise, particularly to you, Lynn, because you're right next to me.
I love it. I think it's a great accent.
Well, thank you. So let me introduce our panel to you. We have Lynn Nicholas, the President and Chief Executive Officer of Massachusetts Hospital Association. Spiros, I can't see your things. Hatiras, President and CEO of Holyoke Medical Center. Norm Deschene, the CEO of Lowell General Hospital. Dr. Ralph De La Torre, the President and CEO of Steward Healthcare. And last but not least, Steve Walsh, the Executive Director of Massachusetts Council of Community Hospitals. So let's start with the easiest question I'm going to ask you. Just give us some sense of your vision for the future of community hospitals. Let's start at the far end of the table with Steve Walsh.
The future of community hospitals. Thank you, and thanks to the Health Policy Commission, all the commissioners that are here for the terrific work that you do each and every day on behalf of our members, but on healthcare as a whole. And I see some of my board members in the room, so thank you for your support. Community hospitals are struggling. But it's no different than we've seen in other industries over the years. Let's take the mom and pop shops for a second. So you used to be able to walk to your mom and pop store and you'd buy what you need. And what put them out of business? The malls. The malls came in and they went out of business. So you used to be able to walk to your community hospital. Now their community hospitals are struggling and you can't necessarily go and get the care that you need close to your home in all instances any longer. But what has replaced the shopping malls? I read an article the other day that said the malls are dead and they're being replaced by lifestyle centers. So the future of community hospitals are in lifestyle centers. It's going to be offering wraparound services so that you can get everything you need close to home, whether that's prevention and wellness, whether that's your local care, whether that's behavioral health, whether it's substance abuse. That's going to be the future. It's going to be in healthcare pods. So we keep care close to our home, but it may be that there's 50 med-surg beds, 5 ICU beds, 10 behavioral health beds. But that's going to allow our community to continue to have their most visible and viable asset in the community hospitals. That's what the future is going to look like 10 to 15 years from now, and that's what we ought to get behind to make sure that one of our most cherished resources that have taken care of our loved ones for so many years are taken care of by us and our policymakers moving forward.
So I think it's important to figure out the problem we're solving for, right? So moving forward, what we're trying to do is create a healthcare system that is both the highest quality we can achieve, but also one that we can afford and that has equality within the affordability, right? We don't want to build a healthcare system that is affordable by the top 10% and not affordable by the other 90%. So when you think about it from that matrix, you really think about an integrated healthcare system in which the right site of care is what is customized for the entire population. So you don't want to do it in an academic medical center what you could do in a community hospital. Similarly, you don't want to do in a community hospital what you could do in an outpatient setting, or in an outpatient setting what you could do in a primary care office, or a primary care office you could do at home. It is our responsibility in the new healthcare model to have great quality, but to do it in a way that is affordable and convenient for the patients. So within this model, what is the role of the community hospital? Well, the community hospital's role is to provide care that is of the highest quality, equal to, in most cases, if not better, than the academic medical centers, but not to impinge upon the outpatient components where care can be provided also. So it creates a niche for itself. One of the problems that we have in achieving this goal is the inability to compete in a free market environment, right? So community hospitals can't actually compete because their lower rates and their lower costs do not necessarily translate to immediate premium relief for patients. Similarly, because of the situation that we find us in with the price disparities, we have such an unbalanced market that even in a society that protects against monopolies, when you have a totally, and believes in free market, when you have a totally unbiased, a totally biased situation, so heavily weighted, the market can't correct itself. Asterisk CAT&T back 30 years ago. That's why it had to be broken up and government intervention. Now, I'm not one to believe in much government intervention, trust me. But at some point, it's kind of what got us into this mess, right? It's the inability of passing cost savings. One of my famous quotes, which my PR team kills me for all the time, had to do with costs. And people ask me about how the impact of cutting costs in our hospitals and our system. And it says, the problem with cutting costs is that if it doesn't translate into premium relief immediately, it's like peeing in a wetsuit. It gives you a warm feeling, but nobody notices. You know? So I think that in the future, we have to create a role within community hospitals that is balanced both in its payment, that translates into actual premium relief and the highest quality for the entire population at home. And we have to be very careful because what we are absolutely down the path in, if not significantly in Massachusetts, is creating a two-tier system. We have a tier where people who have commercial insurance get one level of care, and people that don't have commercial insurance get a different level of care. And that is borne out if you look at the total medical expenditures by population and you look at the richest and poorest communities. It's even borne out in mortality between the richest and poorest communities. We have to be very careful that if we don't correct the system, we're going to create a two-tier system.
Thank you. We're all glad you wore your work clothes today and not your wetsuit.
Absolutely. Well, I think being the third speaker is probably a little easier than being the fifth speaker, but we've got all, we're going to start to sound redundant. Short of the
comment. Lynn's writing some really interesting stuff.
Short of the wetsuit comment, I pretty much agree with what Dr. Della Torre has had to say. We are on the verge of creating a two-tier system that will result in a have and have not society. And anything that continues to move us in that direction, we have to do use all of our efforts to try and thwart that, because it's essential that community hospitals play a significant role in care in the communities. The goal here is not about community hospitals, but is how is care going to be delivered across the state. And if we're going to create a system that provides, we have heard right care, right setting, right time, but we also have to add the fourth dimension, which is the right cost. And in my delivery system, we also have lots of discussions at times that sound like the antithesis to what we want to do as healthcare providers. We talk about providing care in lower cost settings, driving emergency room visits down. moving more patients to the outpatient setting, reducing the utilization of high-cost diagnostic tests. And that sounds like it's against the old model, but that's what the kind of thinking we have to think about. We also have to have hospitals think beyond the bricks and mortar that have been traditionally seen as the hospital, and think about the entire continuum of care and what role they're going to play in providing that glue that holds care together in the community, and encourage, and certainly one of the secrets of the success that we've had in Lowell has been the alignment we've had with physicians and the rest of the system. We provide grants to organizations that are providing small elements of healthcare in us, in our community. And it's because they have a vital role to play, and the hospital doesn't see itself as the only one who's providing the role in care. So as we move forward, I think communities have to look to their organizations, to their hospitals, to provide some of that leadership, but certainly is not the sole source of provision of total care for the community. Right care, right setting, right time, and at the right cost.
First of all, I want to thank the HBC both for the report and inviting me here today to sit on this panel. I particularly enjoyed the pronunciation of my Greek name with a wonderful Scottish accent. Those rolling R's that nobody else can do, so that's great. Thank you. So, again, being the fourth year, I don't want to repeat some of what the other folks have said, but I think the most important quote I saw in this report was the quote about, you know, community hospital versus community health systems. And for the record, while I'm the CEO of Holyoke Medical Center, I'm the CEO actually of Valley Health Systems, which includes VNA, and includes physician practice, includes outpatient settings, and includes a behavioral health and community mental health center. So, I think that that's the key. The key is that we can't live, I don't think, or deliver good care without those community hospitals, but they got to be, you know, they got to go outside those walls. And the real challenge is, though, giving them the resources to do it. It's not lack of ideas. It's not lack of want and effort and hard work. It's usually lack of resources. There's an idea that dies on the vine because you just simply can't afford it. And, you know, if we're operating with what you would call a first-generation EMR, for example. Within that, we've done wonders in our community, creating an HIE, connecting to the state and all that. We can't even have the conversations about, you know, replacing our EMR. It's unthinkable. You know, we've scraped together what we can to build a new emergency room, which is falling apart. And that's about it. We maxed out our balance sheet. We maxed out our debt. We can't have those conversations, let alone having conversations about should we switch from this to that, you know, should we do a big Epic implementation. Sorry, I don't mean to plug Epic, but that's what everybody talks about. It's just we don't have the resources. But beyond that, I think the future of community health is really those community health systems with all the pieces that tie it together.
Well, it is hard to be last. First of all, I thought this was a fantastic report, and I have poured and poured through it, and I commend that. I'm going to share it with the American Hospital Association. I think these conversations are going on in virtually every state, and it's the exact same scenario, with the exception of those states where the academic medical centers, the only AMCs are public health hospitals, and in those states, the community hospitals have all the resources and all the money, and the distressed hospitals are the inner city public hospitals. Having said that, because I represent such a range of members, no matter what I say, I'm going to please some people and displease some. So those of you who know me know I just try to be honest. I really think that the future will be that there will be systems of care. Those systems will be hardwired. There will be some virtual relationships, but virtual relationships are year to year and can be undone as market conditions change or politics change or whatever. So I do believe in hardwired systems. If you really look at the list in the book here of what are considered independent and affiliated hospitals, community hospitals, and you take the ones out of the list that have national affiliations or out-of-state affiliations, there are only 10 truly independent, not affiliated with another licensed hospitals left in the state. And I know of a few of those who are working on trying to be part of systems. So I do think, and Spiros and I had a great conversation about that. I visited him out at Holyoke last week. I think that's the model. I agree with Steve Walsh. in that community hospitals as we know them today cannot exist to be all things to all people, because the academic medical centers and teaching hospitals are going to become more and more tertiary and quaternary. The community hospitals and everyone is going to lose more and more business to retail care, home care, and alternative settings, kind of the scenario you described. And community hospitals have a vital role in being the linkage to both of those ends of the spectrum, I think, as part of a system that is contracting together, that is taking alternative payment, that is covering a region and or parts of the state through per member per month type contracts, and it will be a very different environment. Some of our members in many places in the country are already there. They're already working in that environment. Others are not yet, but I see that as the inevitable place, and I agree with Dr. Dellatore and others who've said in the end it's about the greatest value. And so probably a distributed system where care is delivered in many different venues and not as building-centric as we know it today is probably the future in my mind.
Great. Thank you all. So there's this intriguing and seductive phrase in the report about moving from community hospitals to community health, and you've all touched on that to some extent. You described different models. The big question, I guess, is how? How do we get from here to there? And I'm just going to open up.
Sure. And so a little bit about Stuart, which you may or may not know. Everybody focuses on the fact that we have 9 hospitals. We have between actual physicians and mid-levels, 900 primary care providers, 1.2 million paneled lives, 27 urgent centers, 3 million outpatient encounters a year, 400,000 home health encounters a year. We're not a hospital company.
Right.
Okay. We're a healthcare system. We own hospitals, community hospitals, as a way of providing lower cost care to our mechanism of our patients. Because almost virtually all of our contracts are full risk contracts with significant quality kickers. So we have bridged that gap dramatically. The only contracts that we don't have alternative payments for are ones that aren't available. Systems that are moving that way, but like Medicaid, who's actively moving that way, but can't do it quite yet. So we've made that leap, but I want to focus on how to make that leap. Right, one of the problems that we continue to have is because of the imbalance in the payment structure with some of the larger providers. Okay, we're unable to compete in a cost-effective fashion for the commercial patients. I mean, let's just be honest, right? You know, the Medicare and Medicaid patients, for the most part, can't get into a car and travel an hour and a half to 2 hours to downtown Boston. That's why you see the radically different payer mix between the community hospitals and downtown hospitals. And if you open up a primary care clinic and you're an AMC and you open up a primary care clinic, a surgery center or something in our neighborhoods, one of our neighborhoods, you get 50 cents on the dollar more for everything you do. The only patients that go into town are your commercial patients, depriving our hospitals of commercials and leaving behind what Medicaid and Medicare you do. So it's a double whammy, right? It increases our cost because we're at risk for those patients and we're paying more for those patients, but it actually takes our commercial patients away. And we had the luck, or the fabricated luck, to have a large, huge capital infusion. In order for other systems and other hospitals to do it, the state's going to have to help them, right? And the state's going to have to help them in two ways. It's going to have to figure out a way to give them grants and ways to build EMRs, to build the IT they need to be able to be competitive and join their physician networks and manage risk, which is not easy. Tell me, we manage billions. It's not easy. And in addition, it needs to level the playing field so that you won't be losing all those commercial patients, right? And that vicious cycle that David Seltz put up is so true. I mean, that's exactly what happens. And I think we've gotten to a point where we need help. The free market is just not going to fix it on its own.
I do want to come back to that challenge, but others on this.
Yeah, Derek, I want to I want to add to what Ralph said. First of all, I thought we should have just stopped the panel because Lynn agreed with Ralph and me in the same paragraph. We ought to shut the lights off and go home because that the world is going to end about 5 o'clock today. Here's the issue around community health. The hospitals, the community hospitals in the room, they're already doing what you asked. The premise is incorrect. They already are community health providers. They already provide the wraparound services. Where they are getting literally killed is the things that are beyond their control. We can only ask a community health CEO to control the things that are within their prism. They can't control the fact that brand gets 400% the price on, in some occasions. They can't control the fact that there's 100,000 lives of leakage out of our communities because of brand. Because people aren't loyal to their community hospital any longer. They can't control the fact that limited service clinics, or at least unaffiliated limited service clinics, set up down the road, cherry pick their commercial payers, and don't have to go through the DON process, don't have to pay the same community benefit, don't have to do the same things in the community that they do. Those are all outside influences that are hurting every community hospital CEO in the room, and that's beyond their control. That's where the Health Policy Commission and CHIA and DPH and stakeholders and our friends in the legislature have to say, we want to help community hospitals to be able to succeed because they can't fight brand, price, and competition or unfair competition without some external help.
So I think that circle of the circle of challenges, actually, I do agree, was probably the best sort of part of this report. I loved it because it summarized all the challenges. So the question is, how do we get to the community health system? We got to disrupt the cycle, and where is the best place to disrupt it? I will just tell you that we're conducting a small experiment in Holyoke. When I started there 2.5 years ago, the system was in the typical state of a community hospital, meaning that trying to make ends meet and being really afraid to invest in anything and just kind of bunkering down and basically hoping for the best. And so branding was non-existent, marketing, patient amenities, expansion in the community was all non-existent. So 2.5 years ago, we realized that we were continuously losing market share at an accelerated rate. So we said, okay, we're gonna change this. We're gonna take risk. Okay, we're gonna forget about bunkering down. We're gonna see what savings we have. We're gonna see what grants we could get, what innovative programs we can scrape together. We're going to max out our balance sheet, and we're going to go out, and we're going to do the kinds of things that other systems can afford to do, which is branding, some basic amenities for our patients, expanding the community, opening smaller outpatient settings, and being able to treat people in the community and see what happens. And I will tell you what's happening is we've recaptured market share at an amazing rate. I mean, at this point this year, we have 20% more market share, which we don't even know exactly how to handle at this point. The problem is we lose money on every single one of them, on every single one of them. It's like I say, you sell hot dogs at a loss. If you sell more, you're just going to lose more. So the way to disrupt the cycle is exactly at the point where it says there has to be a fair and equitable payment structure so that resources are available. That's where we need to disrupt it, and everything else will flow.
So I don't think that the changing the perception of consumers about where they want to go for their care, you did the focus groups, the research has been done, I don't think that can be changed. I don't believe it can be changed because to change, first of all, people don't pay attention to the data even when it's given to them. Perhaps by pointing this issue out more and more and more, it could have an unintended consequence where it just reinforces that bias, kind of like the people who think that the higher the price, the better the quality, when we know it's not necessarily true. So I worry about strategies that try to change what is human nature. And I worry about strategies where we depend on employers to change benefit design so stringently that it will force people to make different decisions, because I don't think they're willing to do it. They make it clear that they don't want to be in between those decisions, between their employees and their health care. It's a personal issue. When it's your health, it's personal. So if that's not going to work, in my mind it's not, what can we do to play to the strengths of community hospitals? So the data was really, really clear that they have a disproportionate amount of vulnerable citizens and vulnerable services, behavioral health. We're looking in our own discussions at MHA around price variation at the hospitals that offer what are considered losing services, services that do not pay for themselves. And some community hospitals offer a great deal of those. Some, quite frankly, offer virtually none or very few. But there could be ways to, we know that behavioral health is the most, is the service that loses the most money and is in the biggest demand and is the most underserved. So maybe we should consider, as we try to shift more payment to behavioral health, as we try to improve it, why not do that on a variable basis? Why not, instead of all behavioral health payments, new payments, if there are, if we can come up with some, are the same for everyone, why not make those disproportionately loaded to benefit those hospitals that have high government pay, that are doing, even if they have good commercial pay, if they're doing more of those services than someone else? Those are the things that are eating at their bottom lines. So I think through payment strategies designed to, it's almost like Willie Sutton robbing the bank where the money is. Why don't we target the remedies to the services that the community hospitals are already doing? And I'm not saying don't try to get people to come back and stay in the community, but if that's not going to work and we don't do some other things, then we haven't helped them at all. So I think there's, I have a lot more ideas in that regard, but it's kind of that kind of thinking that I'm looking at. And one last note on that, Medicare does that. Medicare's payment strategy recognizes that. MassHealth's strategy, by virtue of MassHealth patients or different kind of patients, they recognize that. But commercial payments are absolutely blind to it. They have no responsibility. They feel no obligation at all to have any kind of variable payment structure for those communities that are disadvantaged in that regard.
So I disagree a little bit with Lynn in that, you know, my past success and my future and my present is all predicated upon the fact that I do believe that I can change, that I can bring people back, that I can create a brand, and that I can deliver services locally in the community at a cost-effective price point. And that's sort of what my total being is about, and really is the story of this, of success in Lowell. Creating aligned incentives with our physicians and allowing them to share in some of the benefits, but at the same time creates a willingness and a desire to have those difficult discussions with patients about being able to get care local and the quality and the cost that's available locally versus going somewhere else to a more expensive setting. We've also been able to export, have some of the AMCs export some of their services. So our alliance, recently we formed WellForce in conjunction with Tufts Medical Center. And that was really designed not to just send patients to Tufts Medical Center. It was really designed to keep care local. And through their efforts of a distributed academic medical center, they really believe it. And they've been able to export a number of individuals to Lowell to perform services, whether it's surgical, manning our intensive care units and the like. The result is that Lowell's case mix index is now 1.54, one of the highest community hospital case mix indexes in the state. And it's not because we didn't, it just happened. It's because we've been building program and services to be able to deliver that care locally and keep it locally at a real effective price point. And so finding partners who are willing to help to support the growth and delivery of healthcare close to home, I think is as important and is part of the strategy. And the other part that I should mention is that it is about the delivery, as Spiros said, being able to look at the entire system and be able to have strong partners, whether it's from pre-care, primary care, all the way through post-acute care, and be able to align, again, their quality metrics and their total dedication to patient-focused, patient-centered care, again, a key ingredient to our success.
So I'm also going to disagree a little with Lynn here, because I actually think you can change perception, and you can change it. You know, our retention rates from when we first created Stuart 5 years ago to now have gone from 35% to almost 70%. So we retain the vast majority of our patients. What we can't impact is the colonialization of our towns and cities. So when you have an academic medical center that can drop a colony, that because of its higher pricing, just like in the old days, England got money from, you know, the island and was able to do what it did, they're getting money from the mothership and the higher rates, we can't compete. And so we lose in the community those patients. And when you lose those patients, that alters the entire payer mix of the community, which we feel responsible for, and makes it very hard to provide the same resources. Now, it doesn't make sense, and this is what people don't understand, right? It doesn't make it harder to provide the hospital resources. It makes it harder to provide the non-hospital, the care management, the population health, the stuff that doesn't actually reimburse. It makes it much harder to provide that, because usually you provide that as part of a larger package. And if you're bleeding money through a payer mix, you can't provide those components. So I actually think you can change patients' mind. I actually think you can move volume, but we need a solution for this. Now, again, I do want to agree with Lynn that I don't want to speak ill of the academic centers. I mean, I trained at one. I was there for many, many years. I was a heart surgeon. I was chief at one. And this is well documented. You know, one of my best friends runs one. And there is a role for them. Okay. Yeah. Stuart has a system-wide agreement where we send almost 3,000 trauma patients to partners a year. Why? Well, because right now we were faced with a build or buy, and I decided that Boston needs another quaternary academic medical center like I need another hole in my head. So it was better just to partner with one, and there's a role for that. You know, we're not going to build an interventional neuro suite anytime soon because I think we got plenty of those. So there are roles for them. But part of that role, and I think, you know, and I had a long conversation with one of my AMC peers about this, the hard part for AMCs is parts that we face, which is a culture change, right? And the culture change that needs to happen is all the way from the nurses and physicians all the way to the administration. When you're born and bred and trained at an academic medical center, you fundamentally feel that if you don't get the patient there, someone's going to kill them. And there's got to be a change in that culture. And the only people that can change that culture is the administration. And they're not going to change the culture until there is a financial impetus to change that culture. There is human nature.
Yeah, there's one thing that every single community hospital in the state has in common. They have all sent a patient to an academic medical center. This is not a negative towards academic medical centers in any way, shape, or form. But I think consumers are really smart. And I think employers are really smart. And we have to get aggressive. It's time to start telling the story. What other industry, just pick one, another industry that the quality is exactly the same and the price is $1,000 to $4,000 more per person, per item. If I bought that on my American Express card, they would send me back money, I would have the price protection. So I should go down to an academic medical center and I should swipe my American Express card and then I should get the same service in my local community hospital and they should put $4,000 back on my credit card because it's the same service, same quality, $4,000 more. It just absolutely makes sense. We can fight brand. My four-year-old walked around the house last night and he's singing, Nationwide is on your side. We can fight brand if we collectively understand how to tell the story. Because it's not a shell game. We're selling a story that actually works, that makes perfect sense. We just have to collectively, a lot of smart people in the room, collectively tell the story how collectively we can fight brand by keeping care close to home. And I'll tell you what, the consumers in North Adams, the consumers in Quincy, and the consumers in my hometown of Lynn, they wish we told the story sooner.
That's a nice, I'm glad you're not against my academic medical centers. That's really good to hear. to see how passionate you were if you were. And you should never raise the specter of English colonialism when you've got... But just before we go out to the audience for some questions, the thing that was running about in my mind, and Steve Walsh's final comment really kind of reinforced it for me, is that there's, I think, a real risk here that as you respond to this wonderful report, that you do so individually and separately as systems and hospitals, and you reinvent some wheels and you tackle some issues that your colleagues and partners have challenged. What do you think this community of community health providers could do together? What collectively, where do you think your focus might be? You want to start?
Sure. I think for community hospitals, if somebody leaves one community hospital and they drive to another community provider, another community hospital, we have to see that as a huge success. We have to work together as a community hospital network, right? We have 32 hospital members. There's another 9 at Steward. If anybody goes anywhere within that network, we should celebrate. It's if they drive past the community hospitals and they go to a setting where they don't need that care at that time, that we should all get together and fight that. Because pretty soon, we're not going to have our community hospital to be able to go to. And when your son or daughter skins their knee or whatever else, and they end up getting stitches down in aisle 6 in Walmart, we're going to say, what happened to our community hospital that provided local incentives, local jobs, and local high-value care?
And following up on exactly what Steve said, I think the way to get to the root of that and drive that is through the financial infrastructure which subtends it, right? And the financial changes need to be aimed at really two things. One is freeing up control of cost of goods sold. What do I mean by that? When I take care of my patients, and I am handed the huge price differential with academic centers, I don't have the option to negotiate or to lower that part of my cost of goods sold. So all of a sudden, the product, the healthcare, which I am relaying to my patients, has a component which is very high, very fixed, and uncontrollable. Problem one. Problem two is I don't have the opportunity to compete at the premium level in a market. Right. So even if I cut my costs and improve my utilization, that gets blended across all of the platforms and gets offered to the patients, and everybody gets the benefit of my costs, not just my patients. And that is unfair. So I think those are the two thematic things that need to be addressed, either together or independently. And we can argue all day, probably for weeks, on how to do that. But those, there are myriad of ways of doing that. But I do want to just say, follow up on one thing. Guys, it's not just a commercial insurance. Laura's in the audience. I want to make sure we're not just beating up on the commercial payers. It's not just them, okay? The MCOs, GIC, Medicare has enormous price disparities, right? So what kills community hospitals is not the Blue Cross and Blue Shield pays more or less. It's the weighted average payer rate that we get compared to, it's the fact that there's less commercial. It's the fact that Medicare, because of GME and IME, often pays twice as much for academic centers. All that factored in makes it a revenue line. So in its last year of operation, Quincy, from operations, not the write-down, lost $40 million. We put $40 million of just pure operational support to try to keep it open one last year, see if we could take a turn. If it would have had Brigham rates, it would have had a $10 million profit. That's all you really need to know.
On the issue of what hospitals can do together, and I do want to say that my comments about changing perception about people, where people go, that's sans the types of things, Norm, that you and Ralph talked about, where you actually are, through contracting, aligning your physicians so that you can influence that decision. And that's why I made my earlier comment about why I think systems of care that are aligned around alternative payment are really the ultimate. One of the challenges that's in the report, and I hear it every day at MHA, is that payment strategies that could really benefit community hospitals and make people more likely to receive care in lower cost settings, bundles of care, episodes of care, doing this risk contracting, a lot of the community hospitals say, I don't have the wherewithal to figure that out. I don't have the technical specialists. I don't have the data and information I need. My payers will only give me so much. I need a bigger picture. I need data from CHIA. So I think working together as a community, and we hear this from the from our physician members as well, where we learn together better to do bundling, episodes of care, value-based payment structures that will cause a migration for those reasons, not just a brand reason, to stay in the community hospitals. So, you know, we want to work on that. I think the HPC could help with that. They're tremendous tools. There are successful models that some of our hospitals are using, but not everyone can avail themselves of them, and particularly the more independent you are, the harder it is to figure that out on your own. You don't have somebody from corporate whose job is to study, research, teach, translate, and give you the data. So that's an area where I think that we could work harder to make a bigger value proposition that would benefit community hospitals greatly.
That's kind of where I was coming from. Just think about value as a relationship between quality and cost. probably things you could do to raise quality collaboratively, and some things you could do to impact on the cost side of the equation working collaboratively.
Mm-hmm. So I'm surprised Steve didn't say that, but the one thing that community hospitals can do right away is join the MCCH if they haven't yet, right, Steve? Because that's how we collaboratively work together. But in any case, you know, there's a lot of things we can do. But I would say that, you know, as a takeaway for me, because I'd like to take, you know, sort of attack a problem, you know, one bite at a time. In the next few months, I think it behooves us as community hospitals and academic medical centers. And by the way, let me just say that I actually absolutely agree with everybody else. You know, we're so blessed to have the healthcare we have in the AMCs in the state. And none of what we say has anything to do with how wonderful, you know, they are and what care they provide. We just, as Chairman said, you know, we need to balance the system. So the one thing I think we can do is to come up with an alternative to the ballot question, because on price variance, because I do not believe that that is the way that we're going to resolve this issue with the ballot question. So we, let's take one bite. We have 2 months, 3 months, depending on how quickly we work. Let's come up with a reasonable alternative, and as I've said and I've advocated with my respective associations, is it may not be a solution that we come up with in one shot. It may be where we have to take a few sort of corrective actions until we get to the right balance, but it behooves us to do it and not put it up for public comment. You know, there was a very, you know, interesting article in the Boston Globe. I'm sure some of you read it. If you read the comments, you'll understand why the ballot question is not the right way to do it. Nobody understands it. Nobody can really make that decision for us.
I would say a couple of things. I agree with Ralph when he was talking about the being able to access the healthcare premium and how it translates into what we get paid. And you know, I've told many a payer who's come to town to negotiate a contract that I have to stop getting paid based upon my zip code and get paid upon the value that we provide to the system. And to that degree, I think whatever we can do to translate that into rates that are based upon value, cost and quality, I think is essential to the health of every healthcare organization in the state. And anything that we can do to also get us closer to the premium dollar, because as Ralph said, every dollar we save in the system, we have no confidence that it's going to translate back into premium relief for employers and consumers. And somehow we have to have a more direct tie between those two if we're going to be held accountable. Because when I hear about the rising cost of health care, most people are talking about what premiums are being paid. And I, you know, in Lowell we work really hard to lower the cost of health care, but at the same time, I have no way of being able to measure that in terms of how it translates into premium dollars, because it gets watered across the entire Commonwealth.
Thank you. Let's see what our audience has to ask the panel. The chairman is exercising his prerogative here.
They asked me to speak first while everyone thinks about their question. So this is aimed at the panel, but particularly to Lynn, because I wasn't sure exactly what she said. So we're talking about trying to influence people's choices in terms of where they go, and not force them to go one place or the other. And so we're in a very awkward position, the Health Policy Commission, in that the law itself says, try to make the market work better. You're not a regulatory agency. The state does not regulate rates. That debate is taking place independent of us. And one aspect of the market that is being played out a little bit is the idea of health insurers and employers saying to individuals, if you go to the most expensive facility, then you should be prepared to pay some of that. In other words, you know, in order to make lower costs transparent to the consumer, they have to see, not only know it exists, but they have to pay some of the differential or save some of the money if they choose. So if, to the panel, we have used a mechanism, which has some controversy to it, and I'm not totally in favor of it, of allowing insurance companies to differentiate their product and say, if you go to a lower cost facility, you get special advantages, lower copays, lower deductibles, or the other way around. If you're going to go to the most expensive facilities for fairly routine care, you should pay the difference. Now, Lynn, is that something you oppose?
No.
I couldn't quite figure out what you were saying.
So I'm sorry I didn't. So the construct that you just described is exactly what could happen and could make a big difference. My belief is that employers will not aggressively embrace those strategies because, and I've talked to a lot of employers, and we've had employers on our board, because they don't want the hassle of the backlash. They don't want to deal with it in their HR office when so-and-so comes in and says, I have hairy cell leukemia and I want to go here. But I think that is what should happen. And, you know, the worst thing, what shouldn't happen, is what is happening, and that's just throwing it out there as a direct contribution. Here's your lump of money. Go shopping. Go figure out where to go. Because we know that they don't look at the data and they, first of all, it's hard to understand. It's really hard to understand. And they don't do it. They talk to their neighbor over the fence. So the key is physician alignment through payment strategies, which these two gentlemen talked about very eloquently. The key could be benefit design, but I don't believe employers will do it aggressively enough to make a huge difference. And I don't think the state's going to require that they do it or regulate it. The tiering provision, yeah, people did it at the minimal amount they had to, and it hasn't had a lot of traction, right? So, but I think in addition to those things, we can't forget, and this is a really key point, the amount of commercial pay for every provider is going down every year as a percent of their relative payment. Because 10,000 people turn 65 every year. The average age of life is now 85 and growing. So more and more and more and more of the payment is going to be government pay. For community hospitals, it already is disproportionately government pay. So if we don't address that at the same time, and I know the assessment, the provider tax, whatever you want to call it, secretary, you know, that's a way to try to address that. That's a way to try to get mass health rates up through something. As long as that money stays for in the hospital community and stays for hospital issues, you know, we support that strategy. That's one way to do it. We just need to make sure that we pay for those things that are so grossly underpaid now that they're really hurting community hospitals. Behavioral health, to me, is the number one thing that we should work on in that regard. And Rick, if you can get your guys to embrace, some of these payer strategies, I'd be interested to think if they'll really do it or not. But if you can get them to do it, great. That will help a lot. I just don't think we should rely on that because I'm afraid they won't.
But Lynn, I think the problem is the solution to the problem is right before us, is what you said earlier, which is the payment reform. I mean, we've added 4 behavioral health units. No one has actually paid us a penny more. Why did we add 4 behavioral health units? Because we're at risk for the entire population. So we have a population that we have to provide service for. They need behavioral health. We built it. Funny enough, they didn't need another, positron, so we didn't build one of those, but we build behavioral health. Mm-hmm. By realigning the payment structure, you will solve that issue. The problem that we have, and we recently came to the state, for example, is so we have an issue with violent behavioral health patients, and they are a real problem in our units because you have to literally close part of a unit to take care of them because for them surrounding, protect the surrounding patients. So we went to the state and said, we need help. We will build a behavioral health unit for violent offenders, but we can't fill it. And we're not in the business of taking care of other people's patients for a risk, right? If we should either all do it collaboratively, us and 2 or 3 others that need it, or why don't you fund it? And we had gotten no traction on that. So we need help in select issues, even when there is payment reform, if you're trying to solve for a need that isn't encompassed within the entire contract.
Right.
Let's go out and see if there's a...
Hi, my name is Umberine Nahal. Today I'm here I'm actually recently had surgery, so I'm here as a patient today. My question for the panel is that given the CDC reports that health literacy in this country is at 12% and health numeracy is at 9%, and that we are talking as if this is a very rational decision, but having personally gone through surgery myself, I can say that healthcare is a very anxiety-provoking situation that will reduce our cognitive ability. So to what extent is that a problem in Massachusetts playing into these issues? What are the strategies we need to approach that? Whose job is it to fix it? And do community hospitals have a particular role to play in that?
Great question, and also a great segue to our second panel.
So can I say something quickly on it, because it was one of my points about things we can do? There is a growing body of evidence that talks about sociodemographic factors and health literacy, income, you know, the zip code from whence patients come, because we know that certain zip codes have less community infrastructure and ability and support systems and all that. I think we should seriously look at payments, commercial payments. Medicaid already does it to a degree. Medicare tries to. They're thinking about it. We should adjust resources and payments to reflect those issues, because many community hospitals have more of those patients than not. We've already talked about that. We know the report points it out. And they need help in dealing with it. So I think that is a line of policy that we should discuss. One is if you pay for it, and two, how do you help address it? And the last part on addressing it, if you are in a capitated arrangement and you're paying for the health of a community and you're a hospital system, you will try to address those issues yourself because it's in your best interest to do it, right? You'll make the investments. You'll do things with the school system. You'll do things with the local community, with the churches, with the community health centers. So again, I think it's all about payment reform, payment alignment. Alternative payment unleashes the ability to do those things. And you're right, it's a big... It's an unaddressed need.
And I guess that part of moving from community hospitals to community health is about starting to work on the social determinants of health, not the stuff that are related to payment at all. Steve, you wanted to come.
Thank you. And thanks for the question. It's a great question. But we're all patients. But before we become a patient, we're a consumer. We're a consumer as soon as we start paying for our health insurance. So the time to make these decisions is before you're in an emergent situation, when you may have that inability to be able to thoughtfully look at all the options available to you. That's where employers can help. Now, we need to give them the tools to be able to help. We need to put the tools in the hand of the consumer. But Chapter 224 has a consumer website component to it. It's a start. It's not going to happen overnight. But it's a start to try to put some of these decisions in the hands of the consumer. And that's only half the problem. And Ralph talks about the other half of the problem, which is price. And it doesn't matter so much as the consumer is starting to move back to the community hospital if price can catch up more quickly so those community hospitals can survive and can be around long enough to be able to see the consumer come back through the door. But there's also incentives that can happen. We've talked about this before, and Derek's home country actually, and I've said this before in various places, pays you, gives you a payment, a check, if you have a body mass index below a certain amount, because you are better for the system. Now, as I've often said, I would not get that check this year. However, if that was available to me, if we began to pay patients, right, a payer could pay a patient. They could write them a check for using their community provider and send it to them. We'd still be ahead of the game. So we just need to start thinking more creatively about how to incent the consumer before they're a patient, have price disparity catch up, and then we can all coexist in this situation together. The problem is if we just bring up the price at the bottom, what we've done is we've driven up the cost of care. It has to actually come from someplace or care will get more expensive. So it isn't enough just to rebase rates and bring everybody up to a certain percentage. We actually have to look at the finite pie and work with our payers that control that pie about where that money is going to go. So the system remains whole, but we can all do a little bit better to be able to survive and thrive.
I mean, we have a real-world example of this. Okay, we're the third or fourth largest employer in the state. It's a big patient population that we serve also. We have two products. We have one product that is the traditional defined, you know, product that basically it's an HMO, but you can go anywhere. And we have a limited network product, which is you primarily go to Steward doctors and hospitals with a backup with partners. We have a long deal with partners over our entire employee population. When we first launched it with significant copay differences at the wide open network. We got very little adoption. I mean, probably 15% went to the Steward Partners Network and 85% went to the other. We tried playing the second year with larger copays, larger deductibles. It also didn't work. And then what we did is we put in a pamphlet describing all of the quality and what we do and what we can do locally, but also at what point you can interface with partners. But we also priced the premium difference. right? So we basically said, if you pick the lower premium product, you keep the difference. Mm-hmm. Which what it did is that if you made less than $40,000 a year, your health insurance was for free. We went from 15% to 85% adoption. I tell this story all the time. We actually had to fake an IT crisis because we had to shut down. We couldn't keep up with registering people. It was such a wide change. So I think we got to look back to what Steve was saying. It's when you do it. And then a real brief comment on IT literacy. Guys, the problem is we all talk about apps and computer and logging on. Maybe you guys have a radically different patient population than I do, but the Medicare and Medicaid people don't do apps. You know, they don't do health assessments. The people like us, or like most of us anyways, who actually actively are involved don't get sick, aren't sick. We're younger, we're literate, and IT, and that's not the problem we're solving for. So we could have a huge interaction, and that's great. By the way, I don't think we shouldn't do that because we will get dividends from that in 15, 20 years when that patient population matures. But the 70, 75, 80-year-olds, the dual eligibles, the people that we're solving for now, if you really think that an 88-year-old can access the internet and app, I'll introduce you to my mom. God bless you.
Well, I'll introduce you to my dad, who I rely on for my IT advice. I think we sometimes forget that patients want to be healthy. Mm-hmm. And I think part of our job, part of the commitment that you've heard from this wonderful panel is to really drive forward community health, to really invest in improving the quality in our community health services and to get our shoulders to the wheel. So please thank the panel, and I will hand you back to David.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. We are going to continue this conversation and bring in some additional perspectives. I think we just heard from the panel before us a real commitment to embracing change from all of the hospital perspectives that were there. They are committed to that future state of community health, but as has been said, they face some pressures and some challenges, some of which they can control, and some of which represent external barriers. And so we really wanted to have an additional panel here today to talk about the role of other stakeholders in this discussion, specifically the role of consumers, community groups, the role of health plans, and the role of government, and finally the role of employers. I think we just heard from the previous panel many different ideas about how each of these stakeholders can play a role in encouraging cost-effective, community-based healthcare transformation. I'm going to bring in our next moderator to help guide us through this panel. We have a shorter amount of time for this panel. We're going to do a little bit more Q&A, and then we'll get you on our day. But please join me in welcoming Rick Lord to help moderate this panel. Rick is the CEO and president of Associated Industries of Massachusetts. He is a member, an inaugural member of our Health Policy Commission board, and has been a good friend to the HPC for his entire time on the board. I would note of particular interest, Rick serves on one of our policy committees, which is called Community Healthcare Investment and Consumer Involvement. We call it CHEIKI. He has been a member of the CHEIKI committee since the very beginning, and it really was this committee under the leadership of former committee chair Paul Hattis who really encouraged the staff to take on this work of the community hospital study. And Rick's perspective on this was a personal one. Rick is a native of North Adams and saw firsthand what an impact that closure of that hospital had on that community as the biggest employer in that community in a very struggling part of our Commonwealth, and the efforts that have been put in place to ensure that good access to services can be retained in that community, but in a different form. And so he really encouraged the staff and the commission, provided a lot of leadership in saying, how can we proactively plan? So I want to give him a lot of credit for helping to guide this work and to ask him to help moderate this second panel. Rick Ward.
So good morning, everyone, and let me just start by saying what an honor it has been to serve on the Health Policy Commission since its inception with such great people as our chair, Stuart Altman, but a really dedicated group of board members. And as you know, the best staff around. I can't thank David and his team enough for the great support that they provide. So it has been a great honor for me to participate in this exercise. And as other speakers have said, you know, this problem that we're addressing, the cost of healthcare, certainly is complicated and challenging, but thank God that 10 years ago we began the process of addressing the issue of access, because if we hadn't done that, you know, we certainly wouldn't be where we are today. So just to give that a little bit of perspective. So it's great to be here with such great panelists. I'm just going to quickly introduce all of them, starting at my far right, Mr. Bill Grant, who's the chief fiscal officer for Cummings Properties. And in full disclosure, Bill serves on my board of directors and also chairs the AIM Healthcare Committee. So glad he could join us today. Representative Ron Mariano. Representative Mariano is also the House Majority Leader. It's great to have him here as well. Laura Pellegrini is the President and CEO of the Massachusetts Association of Health Plans. Hi, Laura. Amy Wickham-Slemmer is the Executive Director of Healthcare for All. Hi, Amy. And the Reverend Byrne Stanfield is with the Greater Boston Interfaith Organization. So we really have a great, distinguished panel. Looking forward to the discussion. As the previous moderator mentioned, this panel also is only 30 minutes long, and there's five of you. So I'm going to ask you to keep your answers pretty crisp so that we can cover quite a range of topics. But I'm just going to start off with a general question for all of you. And from your stakeholder perspective, can you talk to me just quickly about how important you feel the role of community hospitals are? And if so, why is that? And why don't we start at the far right with Bill?
Thank you. Thank you, Rick, and David, and everybody on the commission for everything you do on this, this topic. I think overall community hospitals are extremely important to the business community as they service your customer, your employees, for all the things they do, their families. I know when I looked at the report it said that it takes an extra 11 minutes to go into one of the Boston hospitals, having just spent 90 minutes to get here this morning from Andover. I think, David, you might fix that paragraph. But I think it's a tremendous asset for the community and something that every employer has to embrace as this goes forward.
Leader Mariano.
Thank you. And again, thank you to the HPC for allowing me to be a part of this. I think it's extremely important. And as a political person who has lost a hospital, I can really tell you how important it is. The anxiety that a community goes through about where they're going for the emergency health care, how that's going to be dealt with, are extremely difficult issues for elected people to deal with. And I do think that it is a major challenge to lose a community hospital. It's usually the larger employer in the area. It is one of the largest contributors to the economy in the area. And most of the community hospitals are in urban centers, which can't afford to lose any jobs and lose any economic engine in their economy. So it's an extremely difficult issue for us elected officials. No one wants to be in office when they lose a community hospital.
Great. Laura, thank you.
Great. Thanks for having me, and thanks to the HPC for the excellent work they do. On behalf of MAP, we're all in with the HPC, and we think you guys are terrific. So I was reading a report last night, and there was a phrase, the loss of revenue accompanying the shifting patient volume is crippling community hospitals. That wasn't for this most recently released report, but it was actually from 2002. There was a Blue Ribbon Commission that the governor had convened, and during that Blue Ribbon Commission, there was a lot of concern around the health of community hospitals and more care being shifted into the academic medical centers. Since then, we had a pretty lax DON process, and we've seen a whole bunch of academic medical centers move out to the suburbs, providing primary care and other types of care, but they really use that as a feeder into their teaching hospital for surgeries. And so I'm actually, my family's an example of this. I was born at Norwood Hospital. I grew up in Mansfield. Our family lives in the greater Mansfield area. And our hospitals growing up were Norwood Hospital, St. Elizabeth's, Tufts Medical. My family has moved their care to an AMC suburban site, which has primary care. They have a 1,000-person waiting list. And when my folks, people in my family need treatment for routine surgeries, et cetera, they go to a very expensive academic medical center in the city. So I think that there's a lot that government has missed along the way since 2002. From the MAP perspective, we think community hospitals are extremely important. Not all community hospitals are the same. Some are losing vast amounts of money, and some are doing pretty darn well, and they actually have are using market power techniques to actually demand high premium or high reimbursement from insurers because they have geographic isolation. So we need to kind of not lump all community hospitals together, but really look at the ones who are making money and those who are really struggling, and what are we going to do about that. We've promoted statewide planning, which we think is important, so we can ensure that the North Adams of the world, that we're very carefully thinking about those things before they happen.
Great. Thank you, Laura. Amy?
Well, I also would like to thank the Health Policy Commission for a fantastic report and for offering us all an opportunity to reflect on these vital community resources for which so many people in Massachusetts depend on for their health. We believe that community hospitals truly are community resources, and we know that individual consumers are not that wound up about what the cost structure of the hospital is. What they want to do is come in, be well cared for, be known, and be able to go home as quickly and efficiently as possible. And what we believe is that community hospitals have this opportunity, and many are the ears to the ground for what's going on in the community. As the majority leader said, they are incredibly important economic engines locally. It's not just where people get their care, it's where their relatives work. We know that the opportunity for community hospitals to be aware of some of the challenges that are particular to the communities in which they serve is very important. And Healthcare for All spends time working with patient and family advisory committees. Each hospital in the Commonwealth is required to have a patient and family advisory council, and each hospital uses that resource to varying degrees. We're very excited when the hospitals, the local hospitals in community settings, pay attention to those voices at that council that can be reflective of what's actually going on in the community immediately. You know, as you know, the North Adams Hospital last night gathered about 50 people came together to focus on the fact that it's the second anniversary of the closing of that community hospital. And the community is asking for a full-service hospital to be reopened. The truth of the matter is that may not be what's in the best interest of North Adams, but the people are gathering because they want to be healthy. They want to stay healthy, and they want to stay local. And figuring out how to make sure that those resources are available for communities like North Adams, like Ware, like Lynn, is a challenge for all of us, and I actually have great confidence that the brain power in this room will be able to figure out how to make sure they're available when they're needed.
Thank you, Amy. And I'll just add one note about the North Adams situation. As you heard from David, I'm a native there. I still have a lot of extended family out there. I have to really give a shout out to Berkshire Medical Center. They eventually bought the hospital. They have reopened a lot of outpatient services that had been closed entirely. So the community still is being served fairly well. As Amy said, the debate is, should there be a full inpatient hospital? And not clear whether that's the right thing or not. But Berkshire Medical Center certainly has played a great role. So thank you. And so Reverend Stanfield, let me turn it over to you.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you, HPC, for the report and this event. I, of course, agree with everybody that the community hospitals are incredibly important, and the perspective I'd bring is that it's one vital piece of a very vital organism, which is our Commonwealth's healthcare. I'm a Presbyterian minister. I'm not a trained doctor or anything. I'm a minister in South Boston, and I work with a lot of rabbis and imams and really committed lay people in 45 congregations that make up GBIO. And we do that because of the people in our pews. We got into this area, this field, over a decade ago, like others, working on access. Quickly figured out that if you care about access, you got to pay attention to cost. And quickly learned out that if you care about cost, you got to be in relationship with the HPC, and that's what we do, and we continue to do, and say prayers for them along the way. But I can tell you,
yeah.
Ultimately, it's a person in the pew, and I'll just tell you shortly, without going into the details. I had a woman stand up during our community prayer time just 2 months ago, and because of her particular insurance options, had to shift to a different insurance, higher premium, less coverage. She's a diabetic, and her monthly insulin cost went from $50 a month to $500 a month, and that was in the middle of our worship service. I know it's a complicated issue, but I know it matters to my people, so that's why we're here.
Great. Thanks all for those opening comments. So let me ask a question to any of the panelists. I think you'd all agree, and it came out in one of the findings of the report, there's a perception problem, you know, that you need to go to one of the brand name hospitals in order to get really good care. And we know that's why many people choose to drive into Boston and drive by their community hospitals on the way there. Is that a correct perception? And if not, what do we need to do to change it? Maybe, Bill, I'll start with you again. You have, how many, 700 employees?
We insure about 600 lives.
Yeah, 600 lives.
I would agree it's a reality, it's a myth. I'm not sure you can change all of them, but I think we need to try to change some of them. And in my opinion, the way to do that is transparency. The smaller employers just does not get good data as to exactly where their employees are spending money and the types of things they're being treated for. With 600 lives, we get a good amount of data, but not everything we need. I realize HIPAA is important, but many times I think that HIPAA is an easy way to say no as opposed to working to yes, to give the employer the data they need to structure their programs. In our case, by the data we've received, we were able to change our wellness program because our workforce has just terrible cholesterol numbers. So we've been able to engineer a program with a nutritionist to get people to try to look at their diets. It factors into work and to the amount of time people are out. It factors into the amount of time it takes employers to recover from workers' comp injuries. So the importance of the transparency of receiving information on a timely basis is critical so that we can educate the employees to have the ability to make a choice. Someone mentioned earlier that one of the web pages, I think it's CHEER, there's some of that information there, but it's not enough. It's not enough, and it's something I think the employers have to do to embrace the subject. AIM's recent survey showed that many CEOs, again this year, have decided to kick the can down the road further and just switch to high deductible programs as opposed to dealing with a little bit of backlash. I think it was Lynn mentioned in the HR department. I will agree there was some, but sometimes you have to take a step back to get two steps ahead, and I would challenge everybody to do that.
Lauren, you have a comment on changing the perception?
Sure. I think transparency is part of the solution. We've been talking about that also for many, many years. I think that she is required to be working on a state website, how we're going to make that meaningful to employers and consumers. I think it is part of the answer, but when you're facing a serious illness, you're probably not going to turn to a website in all reality. But I think we really need to think, again, statewide planning, but you know, HPC, they have a role. They've done a great job as we look at clinical integration and whether there's value to that. But we really, I think, need to think seriously about moving routine care back to the community. I think we see from the report that we're talking about today, maternity care for low-risk maternity, the difference in price. Why are academic medical centers doing low-risk maternity care and other services that can be done in the community? We've created this problem again. In 2002, this was clearly identified. I remembered it, and that's why I went and looked at the report. And I would say since 2002, we've done nothing really to alleviate the concerns of the community hospitals of care moving to high-priced settings. Instead, I wanted to ask the previous panel about the move of AMCs to the community. Early on, I didn't really understand what that was all about. I now understand that it's really about feeding the AMCs care from the suburbs to ensure that they keep their beds filled. I think we need to think entirely differently about the hospital system. And I think that there is a perception that the AMCs have better quality of care, because when people are really sick and the community hospital can't deal with it, they do go to the AMC and they do get excellent care. Everyone provides great care in the state. The issue is price. We all need to do what we're doing, but we need to do it for less.
I think everybody wants to get in here. Lena Mariano, you, yeah. Then Amy, then
you know, it's pretty basic. If you want to change someone's behavior, and the financial incentive is probably the easiest, the most direct way to do it. We heard a couple of strategies in the previous panel on how to accomplish some of those things. But I think until you do that for the routine procedures that community hospitals do so well, we are going to have a problem. There needs to be a realignment of incentives, and there has to be a return. They have to be a return to the individual purchaser of insurance, so that they recognize the fact that there is a cost to traveling that, and it's not 11 minutes, but whatever the amount of time is, into a Boston hospital. Having experienced that with my own wife, who I was ready to throw out of the car as we drove past Quincy to Tufts, because she wouldn't listen to the simple price structure of a laparoscopic gallbladder operation. It is frustrating. But as my dear friend Steve Walsh used to say when we were on the campaign trail to 224, was our healthcare system is like an open bar. Everyone's drinking and no one cares who's paying. And that was the situation with my wife. And until you realign those incentives so that she understood that this was going to cost her more, this trip, this 11-minute trip, it was going to cost a significant amount of money for this procedure, which was an outpatient procedure, we have a problem. And we're going to continue to have that problem. We heard some strategies in the previous panel on how to address it, but I think that it's going to take a combined effort of the community hospitals to sort of get that information out there to make it in a form that's presentable. We tried, and we're working on things with CHEA and with HPC. When HPC was created, one of the things we were hoping for, and one of the things I think they did extremely well, was identifying cost drivers in the marketplace. And we saw it work with the South Shore Hospital issue. And I think that's one of the reasons why HPC is in existence, and I think it's to its credit that they recognize the problem and avoided, I think, a real, real mistake.
So, Amy, before I turn it over to you, just one comment on the leader's issue with financial incentives, and I totally agree, and I'll just give an example from the AIM perspective, and that in last fall we looked at alternatives to our health insurance for our employees. We looked at tiered networks, my HR person and I. The price differential wasn't very big, frankly. And she would say to me, you know, why are we going to switch, incur the backlash, you know, that Lynn has talked about, for a very small incentive that probably isn't going to change behavior anyway. So, you know, I do think the existing products that are out there in terms of the tiered networks, I don't think they provide a great enough financial incentive to change people's behavior and encourage employers to switch, but that's my perspective, so let me turn it over to Amy.
I would suggest that we don't yet have access to the information that we actually need. So you can press around on increasing some, or increasing the expectation for out-of-pocket costs, which worries me because that has more distinct impact on lower-income people than it might on people who can afford to continue to make that choice, to continue to go to a higher-cost setting. What I believe actually will make a difference is where the outcome is going to be better. You know, having some sense of the value of the dollar that's going to be spent right now, as I think we've indicated in a couple of different ways, consumers use cost as a proxy for value, for outcome, and for high quality. And I believe that we have an opportunity to reset that, which certainly would get to a way of educating consumers. We have the ability to present the information so that it actually has a discernible difference to individuals. So you know where you're going to have the best chance of being up and out of a bed after a knee replacement without an additional infection. Who's providing that level of care? That's the sort of thing that people would shop for if they had easy access to it. And I think those providers who are able to deliver that care should be rewarded and paid for that care. The other thing is, I know that people make decisions, exactly as a couple of people have said, by asking their neighbors over the fence. The conversation is, where did you get the best care? I really want somebody in Massachusetts to have cracked the code of patient-centeredness. So the conversation over the fence is, man, I felt like I was surrounded by a team of providers who knew me, who knew what was important to me, and helped me figure out the care trajectory so that I could get home as quickly as possible. That's what we would be very excited about. And I have all faith that our community hospitals could step in and be part of that solution.
Great. You're kind and patient, yes. It's fair to say we have a perception problem. I want to make sure we do not lose sight of the fact that we also have a pricing problem. The report, folks refer to the price variation issue. We're trying to get ourselves in the habit within GBIO of naming it for what it is, and that's overpricing. Same product, same quality, charge more. And we think that we don't want to lose sight of that problem in addition to the perception problem.
Yeah, thank you for that comment. You know, Chapter 224 was passed 4 years ago, created the HPC, recognized this problem of, you know, overutilization of high-priced facilities, suggested two ways to deal with it. One, tiered products, tried to offer a bigger incentive. We talked a little about that. It also required the health plans and the providers to develop really good quality and cost information, and that consumers would have access to it, and that would be a way to begin to educate consumers about where they get their care. Frankly, I don't feel like we've made any progress there at all. And I wonder if you have any comment on that, and if you agree with that, what do we need to do to get consumers more engaged?
So I'll take that. So the Affordable Care Act requires that plans provide cost information on their websites, and 224 requires that plans and providers have this information available. The plans take this very, very seriously, and the plans have launched websites. At the time that we were dealing with the connector and all that was the connector, they were also working to launch websites. They are available. Plans have done outreach. Whether members use them, you know, is another question, and not everyone is tech savvy. I do think that a state website, even if we, you know, crawl before we walk, maybe with the top 50 procedures, and some public education around that, using government's ability around PSAs to really inform folks that this is available. I'm not sure people trust their health plan or their provider, but I think they do trust that government will give them an unvarnished view of price and quality. So I think that actually is the best place. But that's not going to fix this whole problem. It's a piece of the puzzle.
So can I briefly, Healthcare for All looked at the websites and very much appreciate the plans absolutely have taken it seriously. They have built websites, and if you try to navigate them, they're very difficult. I think there's a way to present information so that it can be used to make decisions, but we're not there yet for sure.
Leader Mariano.
I'm glad to hear people trust their government.
We trust you.
That's good to hear. Bit of a surprise, but good to hear. I really do think when working with Steve to get 224 passed, we recognized that we were asking a lot in a very short time. We wanted to bring literacy to the forefront, and we wanted to do it quickly, and we wanted to make it meaningful. And it is a challenge. The plans have taken up the challenge. HPC and CHEA have taken up the challenge. But I think it is a process, and I think it is a process, and I like the idea about public service announcements. I think that we could do a better job of letting folks know what's out there as far as resources go and helping them make decisions. So.
Any other comments on that?
Yeah, one other. It reminds me of something that really stood out from this report, and that's the importance of the physician recommendation. And that whole shit, I mean, what's happening, I guess it was called physician alignment in the first panel. And I know I want to learn more about it, and we in our organization are, and I'd probably encourage HPC to research more what's going on with those recommendations, because that's, I mean, my family's had some health issues, and we're looking to our primary care doctor. Where do we go? That's just kind of the reality in my family. And I know there have been even, there's some evidence that HPC heard about some physicians getting a discount or money back later on according to where the number's sent to a particular provider. And I think there's got to be more research, or just I want to know more about that, because I think that is a real driver of where people decide to go.
So I was actually, that was a great segue to my next question, because one of the findings was that more physicians are aligning themselves with the academic medical centers. If they're the referral route for care for these people, isn't that a problem? How do we deal with that if that's the case? Anybody want to speak to that?
That is happening. We were trying to dig around for the information, and luckily the HPC provided it to us, that 75% of the primary care physicians are aligned with an academic medical system or hospital, academic medical hospital or system. So, you know, I think that it is a problem, but we sort of live in two worlds here. On the one hand, we're spending a lot of time talking about accountable care organizations. I think ideally those would be provider-led, but because of this whole dynamic with providers under hospitals, they're probably going to be hospital system-led. So I think if you talk to MHA, not to put words in Lynn's mouth, I think maybe you even said it during your presentation, that there will be like a few large systems. So you have that on the one hand, that might be one vision, and then the other vision is people should shop around, we want to have value, people should use transparency tools. So I always see them as competing, and maybe even crashing up, because if you're going to have providers begin to take risk, the way it's going to work for them is to be able to keep folks in their system. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of a competing public policy stance, and maybe at some point consumers will decide what they want. I think we know from purchasing power, they want broad networks, they want PPOs, and they don't want gatekeepers. And that's why we're seeing a large penetration in the PPO market. And it could be employers who say, you know what, I've got to make the widget. I don't really want to be talking about healthcare all day with my employees. So let them have two choices, price it appropriately, and go where they want to go.
So before I turn it over to the audience, Bill, do you want to comment on the role of employers here? Are you willing to be a gatekeeper and take a little pushback from your employees if you change the financial incentives or encourage them to keep care locally?
Well, we actually did that several years ago. Someone talked earlier about the low enrollment when they introduced, I think, the plan at Stuart. And when we first did that with our wellness program, it was the same pushback. We ultimately offered a significant discount. So if you participate in the wellness program, you get a 35% discount off your premiums. And to this day, we're only at about 80% participation, which is a little bit of a mystery. But I think overall, the amount of pushback that the HR department gets, they realize that the employer is there to make their life as simple as possible at the time when their anxieties are the highest. And yes, I think it's something that every company has to do to get their arms around and be a participant. I think we all agree there's no silver bullet here. We just need to continue to do the things, little things along the edges, to work as the rest of these things work through the system.
Great. Thanks, Bill. So now we want to turn it over to the audience. And we have about 10 or 15 minutes, I think, for questions. So Kelly has a mic and question over here. Yes.
Good afternoon. Good morning, I should say. I'm a CFO of a community hospital, and we've been talking a lot about disparity in hospital rates. You know, this panel here has been talking about physicians aligning themselves with academic medical centers. I think if we did the research into why physicians are doing that, there's also a price disparity in the physician area also. So if you move from a community-based setting to an academic medical center, what we call rate lift is huge. So I think that's another thing we should look at as we try to solve this problem, is that rate lift issue within the academic medical centers and the community hospitals.
Does anybody want to comment on that?
He's right. He's
that
right.
That's concise. Thank you.
Well, yeah. but to the point being, I mean, that shows you how complicated and convoluted the problem is. You know, when I walked in here today, I saw Stuart Altman, who I hadn't seen probably in a long time. But my introduction to healthcare was with his 35-member panel that was in 2000, the year 2000. And the one thing I learned from that was that this is a very, very difficult problem. There were 35 members to this committee, and everyone had a different point of view. And everyone was moving in a different direction. And it's trying to work in collaboration that makes this such a difficult problem. And I was glad to hear, you know, that the community hospitals have some thoughts about collaboration and working together, because that's what's going to move the needle. It isn't going to be government. We can prod you and egg you on a little bit, but at some point, we need some direction. We're not smart enough to figure out how this thing is going to look in our little laboratory on Beacon Hill. We need to hear from you folks. So,
Laura, you want to comment too?
Sure. So, Rick, we were really happy to co-sponsor with you a report recently that John Friedman, who's actually in the room, authored for us, looking at a variety of state reports. There have probably been 24 reports over the past few years about what's driving healthcare costs. I mean, we know what ails us, and so to the gentleman's point, market power has been well documented. Market power dynamics in this region have been well documented. The Attorney General first did some reporting where she actually, Attorney General Coakley actually took contracts, which are normally not visible to the public, and there are protections, and actually analyzed those. And they did some really landmark work around market power dynamics. And so I represent most of the carriers that are active in this market, with the exception of Blue Cross, but we have long advocated, since I've been on the job and heading into my sixth year, around we need additional tools to deal with market power. Plans, and one of my plans specifically in 2000, really pushed back on some of the market power forces to say no. And the CEO testified in Washington soon after that how he had four sleepless nights because he thought he was going to lose his company because employers were bailing because they wouldn't have a large system in their network potentially. So we know what ails us. It's how do we fix it? And I think for the providers, moving to the AMCs makes sense for them, financial sense, because they're paid more. But if we really care about community and community-based care, we've got to change up the dynamics.
Right. Thanks, Laura. Can I think we have a question?
Can I just add to that? I think one of the most disturbing things to me as someone who's lost a hospital was Ralph De La Torre's comments in the previous panel. His last year at Stuart, and he poured money into Quincy, he said they lost $40 million, and that they had been paid at Brigham and Women's rates, they would have made $10 million. If that doesn't signify a real problem in the marketplace and how people are paid, I don't know what does. So.
Yep. Great. So, Kelly, I think we have a question over here. Yep.
Hi, Pete Healy, from CEO of BID Milton. It was just to kind of reflect a little on the last two comments. So on the physician piece, I think the thing that isn't understood is that is the coming wave and the next wave. And for the most part, if a physician switches from being private to joining a larger group or another group, they change their tax ID number, they get the rates that company enjoys for their physician payments. That's not actually the case with hospitals. So a hospital like BID Milton joins BID system. We don't get BID system rates, we get Milton hospital rates. Mm-hmm. And these days, those rates aren't going up. It's all about risk and quality care and things that it should be. In the physician community, that is still not the case. I mean, there are some limits on the big groups, partners and others, on how many providers they can add to their panels on an annual basis. But as soon as they come in, they switch their tax ID number, what they did yesterday, they get paid in some cases multiple for the next day.
Thank you for those comments. Some good things for the HPC to be looking into. So I think we have a question over here.
Hi, I'm Ron Dunlap, a member of the Health Policy Advisory Board. So I'm a cardiologist practicing on the South Shore, past president of the Medical Society. The big problem you have is fragmentation. So if you truly wanted to design a community system, you would look across your entire community and pick out the most efficient providers, whether they were in X, Y, or Z system. Because we have such so tightly aligned physicians, that doesn't happen. So the best orthopedic group may be in another group that's not aligned with a given hospital. In our area, because we have five major systems, the hospital now not aligned with any of them. But in fact, we have an opportunity, if we are building a community system, to pick the best providers out of multiple systems not aligned with one. So that conflict and the ability to try to dominate the physicians, align them, employ them, and so forth, has been a big problem in terms of our health. We set up on a trial basis a community access center called iCare Place. Went online for 2 hours. It's $10 a month for the patient to subscribe, but what we listed was the best providers for a given service. 4,400 people signed up in 2 hours, crashed the site because of this, the ability to get this information on cost, value, quality. So that's the type of thing that I think we would have to do across communities in order to try to keep care within those communities.
That's a great comment. Anybody on the panel want to comment, Amy?
No, I am struck by the fact that we're, that one of the extreme challenges is the contracts, the reimbursement rates, and market power. And let me just say, that is completely beyond the control of your patients. So what I think we would want you to know is that if you want us to cross your threshold and you want us to come get care at your facility, then know us, know what's important, and deliver care in a way that makes a difference and distinguishes you from competitors. The average spend in the Commonwealth for community benefits is about $630 million a year. That's an extraordinary investment. And I would suggest it's an investment not often made. It's an exception when the investment is made based on the request and needs of a community survey and the needs assessment that's gone on locally. If you want to distinguish yourself and be known and have the people in the community understand the care and potential that's provided in a local setting, those are ways that I think you can get to know people and understand what some of the local challenges are.
Thank you, and I'm mindful we're at the end of our time here, but want to thank the audience for some good questions and comments, but please join me in thanking the panelists for being really thoughtful. And I think doing a great job of representing the cares and concerns of their stakeholders, so thank you for joining us today. So with that, let me turn it back over to their chair, Stuart Altman, for some concluding remarks.
Well, let me thank our panelists, both panels. They were really great, and all of you for coming. but as David pointed out, and I would reemphasize, having chaired that report in 2002, this problem has been around for a long time, and it's not getting better. And yet you heard almost across the board, you did hear it across the board, that its implications for the quality of care, the access to care, and the cost of care is just getting worse. So we have to look forward. So what I would ask those of you who were in the audience, as well as those of you who participated, this study that we provided is just the beginning. If you have ideas about how we can move forward, that either weren't in that report, or even if they were and you want to emphasize them, you know, send a little note to David. Don't send it to me, send it to David. and I think you heard in many different ways that what we have is really a juxtaposition of all the issues. The price differential and its implications are very real. We're gonna have a discussion about that tomorrow. Many of you have been, we issued a report on that. That's real. Also, the perception and the fact that there's lack of information, and therefore, as a consumer, we sort of all make our decisions, even those of us who think that we know what we're doing, we don't, in terms of where the quality of care is and where good care. I would just add one little thing about going into an academic medical center, even for primary care. You should take your blood pressure before you start and after you've gone through that, not 11 minutes, but the hour, in terms of getting in there and look at the negative implication of getting primary care in the middle of downtown Boston. But that's a personal issue. I did that, and I'm getting my primary care back out in the community. So again, bringing this to a close, if all we do is issue that report and nothing more is done between now and another 20 years, it will be too late. We welcome your suggestions. I'm sure the people in the state legislature welcome your suggestions. This has to be a combination of market forces and government actions. Exactly that balance is up for grabs. I welcome, as I said, any suggestions you might give for us. And again, I want to thank all of you for coming. You can be assured that this is not the final one of these community activities that the Health Policy Commission will be putting on. Thank you so much for coming.
Give me a